do want to lift you higher this morning. We want to worship you and praise you with all of our heart, soul, strength, mind, with everything we have. Lord, you deserve our praise. You deserve our worship. And on this week when we have expressed thanksgiving, today we thank you most of all. Out of all the things we're thankful for, we're most thankful for you and our relationship with you and the forgiveness you've given us and the fellowship we have because we belong to you and the future we have in heaven because of our salvation and the purpose that we live life with because you live in our lives and you give it to us. Lord, we do lift you higher. We do praise you. We want to sing a greater song. We want to lift you up today. Lord, I pray that you would move in our presence. I pray that you would open our hearts to the teaching and the preaching of the Word of God. I pray that you'd open our minds to what you have to say to us. I pray that you would help us to respond now by praising you, by giving financially to support the work of this church and our missions endeavors all over the world, by responding to your preached word. Lord, give us responsive hearts today. Do a work in our presence. Holy Spirit of God, anoint us. Change hearts today. Save that person who is lost. Encourage that person who's discouraged. Rebuke and convict that person who's fallen away that needs to be changed and to come back. And Lord, we just give you our hearts. We give you our souls. We give you everything we have. And we ask that your will would be done in our lives and in this church and in this time together this morning. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Psalm 96 says this: "Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord. Bless his name. Proclaim the good news of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his wonders amongst all the peoples. Give to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Give to the Lord glory and strength. Give to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts." And I would ask you to stand with me. O worship the Lord. Let's stand together and worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth.
together, please. Father, we love you. We thank you for loving us. We thank you for the opportunity of gathering together in your name, lifting praises to your name, lifting our petitions to you, and hearing your word back to us. Father, we pray that you bless this morning every aspect of this service. Help us to understand the things that you have for us to do, and help us to be willing to step out in faith and do that which you guide us to do. Thank you for this opportunity of giving back to you just a portion of that which you've given to us so freely, so abundantly. We pray that as these gifts are received, they will be multiplied to reach boys and girls and men and women around the world with the name of Jesus and the power that he has to save us from our sins. Help us to have a burden for the 6,400 plus people groups around the world that are unreached, even some of those unengaged with no opportunity to hear the gospel of Christ. Help us to give generously during this season of the year to our Lottie Moon Christmas offering, that these boys and girls and men and women would have a voice that would tell them about Jesus Christ. Bless our service now. Bless each and every heart that's here today. You know the needs. We pray that they will find those needs met during this hour. We ask these things in the powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Of course, they beat me many times and they threaten with death. But yes, I have faith in God. They cannot kill me. I'm not afraid.
A stark reminder of the journey we have undertaken to fulfill the Great Commission. For the first time in history, reaching the final destination of our Great Commission journey is in sight. We actually possess the knowledge that no generation before ours had available. We can clearly identify which people groups remain untouched by the gospel, and we have a strategy for reaching them.
The truth is, we've never seen such great openness in the nations to the gospel. So many barriers and obstacles have been removed. It is an opportunity for us to make the biggest difference we've ever made. But for that to happen, we're going to have to pay the cost.
For more than 150 years, Southern Baptist missionaries have traveled paths that required them to risk everything so that those isolated from God's Word could be saved by the redeeming message of Jesus Christ. And people groups once in darkness have seen the light of truth. As believers, we must lay down our own lives. We must continue walking our path, praying, serving, and giving sacrificially to see God's Spirit work in even greater ways.
You have to get out of your comfort zone. You have to get out of your shell. You have to get out of your suburban house or your American dream and realize there's a world that's dying and going to hell every day.
I just reminded the rich young ruler. He comes to Jesus and says, "Jesus, what do I need to be your disciple?" And Jesus says, "Sell everything you have and follow me." And here I'm sitting with my designer clothes and my great gear. Someone's just huddled up in a blanket in a hut. I don't know.
The last miles of this Great Commission journey will require extraordinary commitment.
Christ told us to go and to carry the gospel and to make disciples. and everyone in the church, everyone who is a part of the bride of Christ, is responsible for going out and telling people about the bridegroom and telling people that he is returning and telling people that they need to be ready for his return.
Are we there yet? No. But in obedience, we can get there, fulfilling what Christ commanded us to do together as his followers.
Southern Baptists have followed God's lead to focus attention on bringing all the world's peoples to him. For the first time in history, we can identify the people groups that remain untouched by the gospel. One people group in Africa. Are we there yet?
Not yet.
What more can we do?
I'll go.
People group in Cuba. Are we there yet?
Not yet.
What more can we do?
I'll go.
People group in Turkey. Are we there yet?
Not yet.
What more can we do?
We'll go.
People group in the Czech Republic. Are we there yet?
Not yet.
What more can we do? These groups represent only four small people groups within each of these countries. More than 6,000 exist. What more can we do? What more can you do?
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, as we've listened to this skit, as we've listened to these people groups, Lord, allow it to touch our hearts. Allow us to know that you are unknown out there, Lord, by so many, and that we will just commit ourselves, those finances we can, Lord, and just mainly pray for them, Lord. Pray for the missionaries in our fields, in the fields out there, and just pray for those people who are lost. In your heavenly name, amen. As you see, we just introduced to you Lottie Moon, and this year you have with you some brochures that are in there, and it's "Are We There Yet?" Right now I think of my daughter who's heading for Pennsylvania right now. She has a little one in the back seat, and I'm sure she's saying, "Are we there yet?" And as emphasized in the video there, we're not there yet, but we're heading in the right direction through the Lord's help. And we always got to remember the Lord has to be in everything that we do. And he is. He's there. Knowing that there are over 6,000 people groups throughout the world that do not know who Christ, if you came up to them and said, "Who is, you know, I want to introduce you to a friend of mine, that's Jesus Christ," they would say, "Who is that?" So the need is out there, over 6,000 people. And this week, I want to emphasize our goal for Lottie Moon this year is $22,000. You'll see the board out front here. We have a bridge there to bridge the gap from our church to the world. Yes, we can be a part of it. So throughout your devotions this week and throughout the Christmas season, pray for those that are lost. As you'll see there, you have day one and day two. And day one is a Thai prison ministry. As I introduce our speaker this morning, he has a lot to do in that region of the world. A little bit about him. He was born, and I wish, if y'all will, say happy birthday to him, because his birthday's come up here November the 30th, if you don't mind me embarrassing you. November 30th, 1944, in Arkandelphia, Arkansas. But he considers Albuquerque, New Mexico, his home. He received his Bachelor of Arts degree from Grand Canyon College in Phoenix, Arizona, his Master's degree of Divinity degree from Midwestern Baptist Theological Seminary in Kansas City, Missouri. He's a Doctorate of Ministry degree from Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary in Fort Worth, Texas. He's married to Elaine Grisham from Lubbock, Texas. He has two grown children. four grandchildren. Before he began his mission work, he worked in the IT field, New Mexico and Colorado and Arizona. He pastored a church in Tracy, Missouri, a Baptist chapel, the First Baptist Church in Western Missouri. And then he felt that I think God called him to the mission field. He was appointed a career missionary in October of 1974. He's a general evangelist, theological teacher, and mission administrator for Indonesia from 75 to 89. Southern Asia, in the Pacific, mission work he did all the way through until 2001, correct? Okay. He then left the mission field and came to the IMB home office staff on August 31st in 2001. He was the associate vice president of administration and office of overseas operations from September 2001 to June of 2003. And currently, he's the executive vice president of the International Mission Board since July of 2003, and he currently serves as the interim president of the International Mission Board since August 1st of 2010, when Jerry Rankin retired. And it's with great privilege and honor that I introduce to you Dr. Clyde Metter, Jr.
Thank you and good morning. It's good to be here at Kingsland. I think you just learned more about me than I know, but it is very good to be here with you. I think this is the first time I've been here, and it's a special privilege. I would like to invite you to open your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 45, book of Isaiah, the 45th chapter. I woke in my hotel room in Mumbai, India, and as I began to stumble around the room, I noticed that the newspaper had already been slid under the door of my hotel room. So I picked it up, and as I looked, I immediately saw a big banner headline with letters about 4 or 5 inches high. And it said, "The Lord has come." Now that got my attention. I was pretty sure I hadn't missed anything, but I thought I better find my glasses and read a little more. And as I did, I learned that what it was talking about when it said, "The Lord has come," was a Hindu god by the name of Ganesh. Now, you've probably seen pictures of Ganesh. Ganesh is a Hindu god that's pictured usually with an elephant's head and a human body. He's one of the most popular Hindu gods. Now, Hindus say they have 330 million gods. If you try to make your own god, you have to keep trying over and over again. But Ganesh is one of the most popular gods. Each year, on one particular day, people make new images of Ganesh and put those in their homes and their offices and their stores and their classrooms. And this was the day when they had made new images of Ganesh. And because of that, they said, "The Lord has come." That is not the Lord about whom we read in Isaiah chapter 45. I'm reading beginning with the 18th verse. Isaiah 45. Starting with verse 18. "For thus says the Lord who created the heavens, he is God, who formed the earth and made it. He established it. He did not create it empty. He formed it to be inhabited. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I did not speak in secret in a land of darkness. I did not say to the offspring of Jacob, 'Seek me in vain.' I, the Lord, speak the truth. I declare what is right. Assemble yourselves and come. Draw near together, you survivors of the nations. They have no knowledge who carry about their wooden idols and keep on praying to a God that cannot save. Declare and present your case. Let them take counsel together. Who told this long ago? Who declared it of old? Was it not I, the Lord? And there is no other God besides me, a righteous God and a Savior. There is none besides me. Turn to me and be saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is no other. By myself I have sworn, from my mouth has gone out in righteousness a word that shall not return. To me every knee shall bow, every tongue shall swear allegiance. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this special time of gathering together, of praising your name, of reading from your word. And Lord, we pray that in these next moments you might speak to each of us, that we might hear, that we might obey what you say to us. And it is in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Well, in this passage of Scripture, time after time, God says, I am the Lord, and there is no other. If you were to read earlier in this chapter, he says it many other times. If you read on into chapter 46, he says it over and over again. I am God, and there is no other. He reminds us here in this 18th verse that we first read that he is the creator. He is the one who created you and me and everything we know. And he reminds us also that he did not create this earth to be empty. He created it to be inhabited. He created it to be inhabited by people like you and me in order that we might have fellowship with him and that through that he might be glorified. That's the reason you live. That's the reason I live, is that the Lord God might be glorified, that we might be in relationship with him. If you look on down at verse 19, he says, this is not intended to be a secret. It is God's desire that everyone on the face of the earth understand who he is and come into that right relationship with him through the Lord Jesus Christ. You and I understand that the only way in which a person can be in right relationship with God is through a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who came to this earth, who lived on this earth, who died on the cross of Calvary to pay the penalty for your sin and my sin, who rose again, and who's coming again. Only through Christ can we have that relationship that God intends. And God says this is not intended to be a secret. This, all of this is not some kind of fact that has been hidden, but instead it is something that is to be known by all. We've been reminded through the skit a few minutes ago, through the video we saw just before that, we've been reminded that the answer to the question, are we there yet? Are we at the point where everyone on the face of the earth can know this truth that is not intended to be a secret? And the answer simply is, no, we're not there yet. For so many people on the face of this earth are lost in darkness without an awareness of the possibility even of salvation in Jesus Christ. About 10% of the people in the world are believers in Jesus Christ. Now, there are about a third of the world's population claims to be Christian, but a large portion of those who claim to be Christian are what we might call nominal Christians or cultural Christians, who call themselves Christians simply because their parents or their grandparents were Christian, but they have no personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Now, that's not a strange concept to you. You know people just like that around you, wherever you live. Even more than that, even more than the fact that most of the people in the world have not yet come to know Jesus Christ as Savior, a fact that lays very heavy upon all of us, is that about a quarter of the world's population, that's more than 1.5 billion people, more than you and I can really understand what that number is, more than a quarter of the world's population live in people groups where they do not have access to the gospel. There is no scripture in their language. There are no Christian radio and television broadcasts in their language that they might hear the gospel. There are not churches within their culture where they can go and comfortably hear the good news of Jesus Christ. They do not have access to the gospel. But yet that is not God's desire. For God says this is not to be a secret. This is not something that has been hidden. Instead, it is his desire that all hear the truth. Look at verse 20. assemble yourselves and come, draw near together, you survivors of the nations. Or down at verse 22, turn to me and be saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is no other. That is his desire, that every people group on the face of this earth would have the good news of salvation in Jesus. It is exciting when we see the good news breaking through in new people groups. One example of that is a people group called the Songhai, S-O-N-G-H-A-I. Songhai people live primarily in the countries of Niger, Burkina Faso, and Mali in West Africa. A few years ago, there were no believers among the Songhai. And then one year, as our personnel began to work with them, the first 16 people came to faith in Jesus Christ and were baptized in his name. The next year, another 33 came to faith in Jesus and were baptized. The next year, more than 100, and it has increased each year. One place where some Songhai live is in the city of Timbuktu in northern Mali. Yes, there really is a Timbuktu. I've been there. And some of the people who live in Timbuktu are Songhai people. About a year and a half ago, the first Songhai man in Timbuktu came to faith in Jesus. Just a few weeks after that happened, our missionaries and all other foreign missionaries had to leave Timbuktu and go down to southern Mali because of terrorism activities in northern Mali and terrorists coming off of the Sahara Desert into the city there. It's been almost a year and a half. None of those missionaries have been able to go back yet because the situation continues to be untenable. But you know what? That one man who came to faith in Jesus a year and a half ago has continued to witness to other Songhai around him, and the number of believers has continued to increase in Timbuktu. We praise the Lord when he breaks into new people groups, but there are so many more people groups that need to hear the truth of Jesus. It is exciting to see the way God uses some of our missionaries. Some who have most impressed me in West Africa also have been some young women, some journey women. Many of you are probably familiar with our journeyman program, which is for young college graduates who are 26 years of age or younger, who go to the field for usually a two-year, sometimes a three-year assignment. Young women go to villages in West Africa in pairs, go to live in a village for 2 years. When they first go to those villages, and these are villages where there are not believers, these are villages where no Westerner has ever lived before. When they go to those villages, they're usually greeted in three ways. The first way is they're sort of welcome, because what else are you going to do if two young women come and ask to live in your village? You know, they say, okay, and we'll take care of you, we'll watch over you. The second thing that they're told when they first arrive is, you will never learn our language. No Westerner has ever learned our language. And the third thing they're told is, you won't make it here. You're used to electricity and running water and all those kinds of things, and you won't make it here. But you know what? They learned the language. 6 months after they've been there, they're speaking the language fluently, and they're beginning to relate to the people, and they make it. They stay for the full amount of time. And while they're there, they work with people in that culture in order to help them understand the stories of the Bible and put the stories of the Bible in terms, in language, and also in ways of presentation that people can understand it. And they see people coming to faith in those villages among small people groups in West Africa where no one has been touched before. God's desire is that everyone should hear. He calls all peoples to come to him, and it is our responsibility to get the truth to them. There are so many more examples. A couple of our guys were up in northern Iraq visiting a people group called the Yazidi Kurds. Now, you've heard of the Kurdish people. You hear about them on the news regularly, that stateless people group that live, large people group that live mostly in northern Iraq and eastern Turkey, some other parts of that part of the world. But one subgroup of the Kurdish people is a group called the Yazidi, Y-A-Z-I-D-I. Yazidi are pretty different from other Kurdish people, sort of stay to themselves. A couple of our guys were up there visiting with the Yazidi leaders, and they sat around talking, and the Yazidi leaders asked them, "Why have you come to visit us?" Our guys thought about that for a couple minutes. They wanted to answer in a good way, and they said, "Well, we've come because we want to learn about you. We want to know your history. We want to understand your culture." And then they got a little more bold, and they said, "We've come because we want to tell you about a God who loves you." And when they said that, those Yazidi leaders just hung their heads for a few moments. And then they looked up, and the head man said, "We have been waiting 1,000 years for somebody to tell us that they love us." And brothers and sisters all over this world, there are people groups who have been waiting 1,000 years and more for somebody to tell them about a God who loves them. And all over this world, there are millions, yea, even billions of individuals who have been waiting a lifetime for somebody to tell them about a God who loves them. If we go on to the 23rd verse in Isaiah 45, we see it starts out with the words, "By myself I have sworn." If God swears, we should listen. He says, "From my mouth has gone out in righteousness a word that shall not return. To me every knee shall bow, every tongue shall swear allegiance." Sounds sort of like the New Testament, doesn't it? Like Philippians 2, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Now we understand that that happens in its fulfillment, in its totality, at the end of time on the judgment day. But even now we begin to see glimpses of great numbers of people coming to faith in Jesus. And that is an exciting, exciting thing. About 20 years ago, Elaine and I were involved in a ministry centered primarily in the Indian subcontinent. We were leading a group of several couples who did itinerant training around the countries of India and Pakistan and Nepal and Bangladesh and Sri Lanka. We would go one or two couples at a time to a place to train pastors and other leaders who had no other opportunity for training. We'd spend a week with them. The next week we'd go someplace else. The next week someplace else. And that's what we did back in those days. Well, at one point in April of 1990, we heard about a small Baptist group up in northern India in the state of Uttar Pradesh that might need some training. And we were always looking for new places where people needed training. So we went up to visit that people group. We found there in the city of Gorakhpur a group of about 29 Baptist churches. They had been started by Swedish Baptist missionaries more than 100 years earlier. There was still one elderly lady Swedish Baptist missionary living there among them. 29 churches, about 3,000 members all together. It had been 25 years since a new church had been started among them. We asked, "Would you like some training from us?" And they said, "Yes, we would." So we began to make plans for training them, sending some of our folks in. The next day after we left Gorakhpur, Elaine and I went back to the capital city of Delhi. And in Delhi, we had dinner with a missionary couple that had just transferred to India with a responsibility of working with a people group called the Bhojpuri people. As we had dinner with that couple that night and talked about where we had just been, we realized that the people in Gorakhpur were Bhojpuri people, that it was the same people group. So they began to work with them also as we introduced them to them. That was 20 years ago. At first, it was very difficult. The next 3 or 4 years, there was very little growth. 7 of the leaders who emerged in those early days of that movement were martyred. It was a difficult time. But today, among that people group, from those 29 churches and 3,000 believers, there are now more than a million believers. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess. God is moving in beautiful, dramatic ways in many places in the world. One place, for instance, down in southeastern China, in one province of southeastern China, for the last 6 or 7 years, we have seen at least 1,000 new house churches start every month. And figure 8 or 10 or 12 new believers in every one of those new house churches, you do the math. Great numbers of people are coming to faith in Jesus. One of the people groups that was mentioned during the skit a few minutes ago was in Cuba. And it's so exciting to see what God is doing in Cuba. A year ago, I was speaking at the 100th annual convention of the Western Convention of Cuban Baptist Churches. There are two big conventions in Cuba that we work with, one in the western part of the country, one in the eastern. I learned as I was there that those two larger conventions, along with two smaller Baptist groups, had adopted a goal that by the end of 2010, they would see 100,000 new house churches started and 1 million people come to faith in Jesus. Now, I don't know that they're going to reach that goal, but I do know that God is moving in dramatic, dramatic ways, even in that repressive communist society of Cuba. Cuban Baptists have told me that they believe that at least 70% of the 13 million people who live in Cuba, at least 70% have received either a copy of the Jesus film, a New Testament, or a personal witness. Now, I'm not sure you can say that in the Richmond area. I'm not sure you can say that all over the U.S. God is moving, and it is God's intention that every knee shall bow and every tongue confess. And you and I are privileged to be a part of that. Back when we were working in that itinerant training ministry, one couple working with us in the early days of that were a couple by the name of Bob and Marge Wakefield. Bob and Marge served for about 30 years in various parts of Asia. But while they were working in that itinerant ministry, it came time for them to retire. And Bob and Marge thought the best thing they should do before they retire was go around to every one of the groups where they had been doing training and explain to the people that they were going to be retiring and they wouldn't be back again. So they began to do that. One of the places they went to share that message of retirement was up in the Khand Hills area in the state of Orissa in eastern India, a people group there called the Kwi people. Well, Bob and Marge were there, and they were meeting with the Baptist leaders in that area, about 100 folks who were there. And as Bob explained that they were retiring and they wouldn't be back again, a man sitting at the back of the room, a man by the name of Mr. Nike, who usually was a pretty quiet guy, didn't say much in a very big gathering. But Mr. Nike stood up, and he raised up his hand, and he said, "I have a question." And Bob said, "Okay, what's your question?" And Mr. Nike said, "Is anybody else coming? Is anybody else coming?" That question continues to ring in my heart and my mind, as I trust it does in yours. As Christian leaders all over this world are asking the question, "Is anybody else coming to walk beside?" Is anybody else coming to train us? Is anybody else coming to encourage us? And all over this world, lost people are asking a question they don't even know they're asking. Is anybody else coming to tell us about a God who loves us? Something that God does not intend to be a secret. But yet, people have not yet had the opportunity to hear. That question, "Is anybody else coming?" is the question that you and I answer. We are the ones who hold the answer. There are at least three ways, I remind you this morning, that we answer that question, is anybody else coming? The first way is through prayer. For God, in His wisdom, in His mysterious plan, has determined that He acts in response to the prayers of His people. And you and I have the responsibility to be praying for missions. You and I must pray not wimpy prayers asking God to do what we know is going to happen anyway, but we need to be praying boldly, asking God to work miraculously, amazingly, remarkably, to do things only God can do. You and I must pray for the 5,100 missionaries of the International Mission Board, for the missionaries of the North American Mission Board, for missionaries of other organizations, that God might use these men and women to share His truth and accomplish His purpose around this world. You and I must pray for local Christian leaders all over the world, that they would boldly share Jesus and remain faithful and firm in the midst of all kinds of struggles. And you and I must pray for lost people, that they might have an opportunity to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. A second way we must be involved, which we've already been reminded of this morning, a second way we must be involved is in giving. It's expensive to do missions. It's expensive to do everything. But it's expensive to do missions. And you and I must boldly give to undergird the work of missions around the world. A few weeks ago, I went to preach in an unusual place. It's called Calvary Baptist Church in War, West Virginia, W-A-R. It's a little old coal mining town. When I stepped out of my car and met the pastor and his wife, and I said, I've been telling people I was going to war. And they said, well, it's true, not just literally, but also spiritually. It is a poverty-stricken third world town in the middle of the U.S. That little church has about 45 people on an average Sunday attending. A third of those are children. The pastor told me that 8 or 9 people in the church have a paying job. The pastor went there a little over 4 years ago. When he arrived, he learned that their average giving to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering for international missions was $140 to $150 every year. He announced, after he'd been there 3 or 4 Sundays, he announced that their Lottie Moon goal that year was $500. One woman fainted. One woman sort of yelled out. A couple other ladies had things to say to their husbands on the way home in the car. But they gave $1,300. The next year it was more. The next year it was more. Last year, their fourth year, it was over $7,500 in that little church. They caught the vision of boldly giving. Now, how do they do it? I don't know. And I asked them, and they said, we don't know. We just know God does it. You and I are challenged by people like that as God uses His people to get His work done. We must pray, we must give. And the third way you and I are involved is in going, every one of us. You say, every one of us going? Yes, every one of us going. For many, as your pastor mentioned when he was praying earlier in the service, for many that may mean going across the road to talk to your neighbor who's not yet heard the truth of Jesus. For many, it may mean talking to the person at the store where you shop who doesn't yet know Jesus. It may mean talking with a relative or a friend who's not yet come to faith in Jesus. But every one of us goes. But in a church like this, there are so many who can go in other ways. Volunteer mission trips, where you, as members of this church, go for a week or two to work in partnership, in real partnership, with our missionaries in some other part of this country or some other part of this world. You make a difference. Sometimes there are questions and people ask, do volunteers who go for just a week or two really do any good? You better believe they do. You make a tremendous difference when you go to share your faith, to walk alongside, to plow the ground, to do whatever is needed to prepare the way for spiritual truth to break into a new people group, for people to hear about Jesus. You make a difference. And I don't know, I didn't really ask your pastor or others about how much you're involved in partnership with teams on the field, but brothers and sisters, you can do it, and you can make a difference, and God can use you in amazing ways. God can use this church in partnership, hand in hand with teams on the field, in long-time relationships, and see things happen that you might never have dreamed of, and see this church blessed in ways that the church would not be blessed through any other method. Of course, in a group like this, there's a good chance that there are folks in here to whom God would say a week or two every year or two is not what I had in mind. But God might say to you, I want you to be involved in taking the truth of Jesus to somebody who otherwise would not hear for the rest of your working career. Or for young people, for your entire working career. And you may say, not me. I'm not a preacher. I can't do that kind of thing. Folks, there's not a one of us who can do it. And God doesn't ask any of us to do it on our own. It is God who empowers. It is God who enables. When God calls, all he asks is that we say yes. And he does the rest as we obediently follow him. The question is there. Is anybody else coming to tell a lost world about a God who loves them? Are we there yet? No. But we're getting closer. And as you and I are faithfully involved as we should be, in God's time and in God's way, we will get there. In a few moments, we're going to have a time of invitation. I don't know exactly how you usually do it, but we're going to stand up in just a few moments. And we're going to begin to pray. And as we're standing and as we're praying, if God says to you, I want you to be more involved in answering the question than you have been to this point, maybe it's intentionally praying more. Maybe it's intentionally seeking God to give you direction about how you should boldly give. Maybe it's in saying, God, I think maybe you want me to go on a volunteer trip, but I haven't done that before. Or maybe you feel God stirring to be saying something in you that's maybe even more long-term than that. You don't know what it is. There's no way you'd know all those answers today, but you want to say to God, yes. As we're standing and praying in a few moments, I invite you, if God is saying something to you and you want to say yes to him today, you just come down here and pray. Just kneel or stand, whatever works for you down here, and just be saying to the Lord, Lord, I'm saying yes to you. If there's a decision you're making you want to share with someone else, there will be folks standing here to talk with you. But one other thing before we begin to pray. I realize there may be someone here this morning who says,
there is no way I can tell somebody else about Jesus. There is no way I can share Jesus with somebody else. And the reason is because you don't yet know Him yourself. Let me remind you and assure you that the Lord Jesus Christ came and lived on this earth and died and rose again and is coming again for you just as much as for anybody in China or West Africa or any place else in the world. And if you don't yet know Jesus as your personal Savior, today is the day to meet Him. If you don't yet know Jesus, you come down here and talk with someone and let them lead you to the foot of the cross even this morning. Let's stand together as we pray. Our Father, You indeed are God. You are the Creator. You have loved us. You have given Yourself for us in sending Your Son. And Father, we realize, we understand, we are reminded even today that even though it is Your desire that none should perish, it is Your desire that all should hear the message of salvation and respond in faith to Jesus, Lord, we realize we have not done the job. And there are so many who've not yet heard, who have no chance to hear. Father, work in our hearts. Make us responsive to You. Lord, may we be intently people of prayer. May we be intently people who give sacrificially and boldly. And Lord, may we be men and women who go here and around the world to tell about Jesus to those who otherwise would not hear. Oh, Father, work among us right now. Father, I pray that You might work in our hearts and cause us to respond to You as You would have us respond. Lord, we are Yours. Work within us.
As we continue in a spirit of prayer, I want to ask you to think about and to review the admonition we've been given to go, to give, to pray. And I ask that you would respond to what God is telling you to do, not what He's telling me to do. These are very personal issues, giving. Do you know that Americans give more money to pet food than they do to missions? That's a disgrace. You may want to make a decision today that you're going to give more money to international missions, specifically through the international focus through Lottie Moon this Christmas, than you gave to your pet food this year. I would encourage you to make that decision and to act on it. That's something you can do. Most Christians take a vacation, and I'm not trying to take your vacation if you only take a vacation, but you know, I've noticed that many of the people I know take multiple vacations. Maybe your decision needs to be, I'm going to give one of those vacations to the Lord for a mission trip this summer. Now, that's a big decision to make on the spot, and maybe that's not for you, maybe that's for someone else, I don't know. If I were you, I'd come and pray about that today during the invitation. What about prayer? We have about a dozen different missionaries' names in our prayer bulletin out in the foyer. I doubt even Dr. Metter knows the name of all 5,200 missionaries that we support internationally. It's a lot of missionaries. But you can pick up that prayer guide and you can pray for them, some of them by name, others in different ways. My guess is that most Christians spent more time on their cell phones or on the telephone this week than they did talking to God about missionaries. You have your little missionary list there for the week, for the week of prayer. We're going to make a big focus next week on it again. Would you just pray for the folks? We're praying for the prison in Thailand today. But there's different countries every day this week. Would you take that thing and use it? Would you pray for missions? You can do that. You've been given a very straightforward message this morning, and God's word is crystal clear. He wants people to know about Him across the street and across the oceans. If God is working in your heart this morning and you want to spend some time in private prayer, come now and do that. If you want to pray with somebody, maybe you need to be born again and you want information on how you can do that, come down and shake my hand. I'll give it to you. I'll show you, or someone will show you, how you can be born again. You may have another kind of burden on your heart. And let's face it, it's Thanksgiving and we're thankful, but the truth is a lot of us are carrying heavy, heavy burdens on our hearts right now. I'd encourage you right now to just take it to the Lord where you are. Come and pray at the altar if you feel led. Move. Respond to what God is telling you to do, specifically just for you and for your family. Father, I pray that you'd move. You are mighty, and the cross is where we know that the gospel is where our power comes from, not from eloquent speeches or powerful persuasive arguments or anything like that. It's the power of the cross, and we thank you for it. And Lord, I pray that you'd move powerfully during our invitation right now, and that we would be smart enough, wise enough, humble enough to just submit to what it is that you want us to do as far as giving to our missionaries, going exactly where you want us to go with the gospel, and making that commitment to pray and being prayer warriors for our missionaries. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Come as God leads you.
Broken nets, broken nets.
seated. Amen. Aren't you glad that we don't have to operate in our own strength, or our own ingenuity, or our own cleverness? That when we have the gospel, we have something that's powerful, that's life-changing. Do you realize that? God can use your life. God will use your life. And thank you, Dr. Meter, for being here with us today and for sharing and inspiring us through the scriptures. And just want to introduce a couple to you today. Thank God for all the ones who have responded to the Holy Spirit's leadings in their life. But up front here is a couple I've gotten to know over the last few months that have already gone through our new members class, but today they have come forward and requested membership in our church, and that's Russell and Ashley Krupp and their little girl, Kaylin. So we're so thankful they're here. And we are a family, and I hope you'll get to know them. If you would stand before we get done, not now, but when you leave, come and shake their hand, get to know them, and we're so glad you're here. And want to remind you of a few things going on. First of all, if you're visiting today, there's a little introduction communication card thing there in your bulletin. Fill that out if you would and hand it to me before you leave. I'd love to get to know you. Thank you for visiting with us. Thank you for being our guest. And we'd love to get to know you better. Please come back and we'll do that. We will not be having services tonight. Wednesday night is a big deal. Wednesday night, we are coming back for Awana for the children, Contenders of the Faith for the 4th and 5th grade boys, Keepers at Home for the 4th and 5th grade girls. Our youth ministry is exploding on Wednesday nights. God is doing great things. If you have teenagers, you want them here. It's exciting. It's awesome. Of course, Awaken for the younger people, the 20s age, is on Wednesday nights at 8, and you can come for that. Next Sunday night, we will have our children's musical. You want to be here. It's going to be great. Sunday night, 6:30. They have practice tonight at 6, so have the kids back for that. And there's a dessert reception following the big program next Sunday night. There's invitations on the back if you want to invite some friends and family to come to that. Next week, Upward starts. We still need more coaches. We still need more helpers. You may not be a basketball expert. You'll fit right in, believe me. It's not about being a basketball expert. And I thank God for my assistant coach, Justin, who's really going to end up probably being the coach. He just found that out. But no, just kidding. But we need help. Every coach needs an assistant coach. Like me, I need an assistant coach to do all the work. So you can be an assistant coach. You can be a devotions giver. There's 1,000 things you can do. So please let Ray Cash know, or fill something out and give it to me, and I'll get it to Ray about that. And if you want to help with Upward basketball, it's really not, you know, it's 8 Saturdays, January and February, just every Saturday in January and February, and then we're done. So please let us know. We need your help with that. Be praying for Upward. Be praying through your week of prayer list for these missionaries. They definitely need it. Would you stand with me? Father God, we stand in your presence in need of your grace, in need of your mercy, and thanking you so much for giving it to us, for pouring it out on us. We love you. We worship you and praise your holy name, and we want to be a place where people can find Jesus, and we want to be people who take it out of this place all over our community, all over the world, the good news that God loves them, that God will save, that he's mighty to save. Lord, we worship you and we praise you for that fact, and we pray that you bless us as we go from here. Give us the courage and the strength to do what we've been instructed from Scripture to do, to give more than we've ever given, to pray harder than we've ever prayed, and to go more faithfully than we ever have before. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. God bless you.
Hi, my name is Pat Fiordalis. I'm the pastor here at Kingsland Baptist Church, and I want to thank you for being with us for our video broadcast of our service. And thank you for watching. I hope that you enjoyed it, and I hope that you will get in contact with us. If there's anything we can do to help you, our phone number is 275-1285, and you can check us out on the web at kingslandbaptist.com. And we want you to know that we love you. A verse in Scripture that means a lot to me comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and it says that the love of Christ compels us, it constrains us, it motivates us. And that's really what we're all about at Kingsland, and that is connecting people with Christ, because the love of Christ compels us to do so. We've received His love, and now we want to share His love all over Chesterfield County. And maybe tonight you have questions about your spiritual destiny and whether or not you're on your way to heaven ultimately with your life. And I would encourage you to think about that, to pray about that, to talk to God about it. You see, Jesus Christ loves you. He died for you. He shed His blood for your sins. And the Bible says there's none righteous. No, not one. There's none who does good. There's none who seeks after God. So the truth about humanity is that we're born separated from Christ. We're born lost. And we're really born dead, spiritually speaking. And what we need to do is to be born again. That's what Jesus said. You must be born again. And He made that possible by dying on the cross for our sins, being buried, and raising from the grave 3 days later. And you know what? That can become a reality in your life. Tonight, if you want to invite Christ into your life, do that. Ask Him to forgive you of your sins. Ask Him to be your Lord and your Savior. And give your heart to Jesus. And what we're here to do is to help you, help introduce you to Christ, to connect you with Christ, and to help you grow. And that's why we have our television show every Friday night. And that's why we have services here at Kingsland every Sunday. We have Bible study at 9:30 every Sunday morning. And we have a worship service at 11 o'clock every Sunday morning. And we would love for you to come and sing and learn and grow in your faith. If there's anything we can ever do for you, contact us here at Kingsland, 275-1285. And we hope to see you soon. God bless you.